tonight. Take the law into your own hands and hold on to it tight. See the words that I have written there will soon keep us apart. I will write those precious words into your mind and in your heart. In the pages of my word, it shall be clear. The whole earth is waiting for your manifestation. Here's my compass, man of heaven and steel. Here's my compass, man of heaven and steel. Into your own hands and read it tonight. Take the law into your own hands and hold on to it tonight. The words that have been written there will soon keep us apart. I will write those precious words into your mind.
Creation worships you. raise your hands and speak to him personally tonight.
Bye.
worship Yahweh.
We worship Yahweh.
We worship Yahweh. We worship Yahweh. You were faithful to Abraham.
And you were faithful to Moses.
You were faithful to David. And you are faithful to us today. So we worship Yahweh. And when we worship
to the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which is before Yahweh. Amen. Amen. Yahweh is good. Yes, right. All the time. Amen. Tonight is one of the most beautiful services that we do. And for a few minutes, I want to talk to you about this service so that you'll know what you're about to partake of. The Holy Ketoret service. In Exodus 30, it says, Yahweh said to Moses, take fragrant spice gum resin, onycha and galbanum and pure frankincense, all in equal amounts, and make a fragrant blend of incense, the work of a perfumer. It is to be salted and pure and sacred. Grind some of it to powder and place it in front of the testimony in the tabernacle of meeting, where I will meet with you. It shall be most holy to you. Do not make any incense with this formula for yourself. Consider it holy to Yahweh. Exodus 30, 34 through 37. So the offering, the incense, is the highlight of the Yom Kippur service. The high priest enters the Holy of Holies with a spoonful of ketoret, or incense, in his left hand and a pan of hot coals in his right. He places the pan on the floor in front of the holy ark, and then in specific fashion, He transfers the incense from the spoon into his two hands onto the coals. If the smoke fills the entire Holy of Holies, then the high priest knows that Yahweh has forgiven the sins of the whole commonwealth of Israel. The high priest then leaves the Holy of Holies, slowly walking backwards. I call to you, Yahweh, come quickly to me. Hear me when I call to you. May my prayer be set before you like incense. May the lifting of my hands be like the evening sacrifice, says Psalms 141, 1 through 2. Now we have discussed the concept of tikkun, or the restoration and reconciliation of all things. And I've taught you about the tsimtsum, the shattering that occurred first when the angels rebelled, and then again when Adam and Hava or Eve rebelled. We talked about many of the instances of tikkun, or repairing, that Yahweh has committed to reconcile mankind back to Him. It was even at the great tikkun of the giving of the Ten Commandments that mankind fell again in the making of the golden calf. In fact, the breaking of the tablets on Sinai paralleled the original shattering of creation in the Garden of Eden with deadly seriousness. After the great sin of making the graven image, knowing that man was optically stimulated, Yahweh gave man the tabernacle as a place where His glory could be seen. Central to all the ceremonies conducted in the tabernacle was the Keteret Basamim, or the incense offering. Keteret consists of a precise mixture of 11 holy spices: balsam, clove, galbanum, frankincense, myrrh, cassia, spikenard, saffron, costus, aromatic bark of cinnamon, and cinnamon proper. The 12th bowl consists of karshena lye, cypress wine, sodom oil, smoke-produced herb, and Jordan amber, used to treat the 11 spices. They were not part of the Keteret per se, but they were part of the mixture. After treating and grinding each separately, they were blended together into a special mixture to be used in the temple. Take fragrant spice gum resin, onycha, and galbanum, and pure frankincense, all in equal amounts, and make a fragrant blend of incense. So it was to be ground and blend together. It would be the worker of a perfumer. In other words, a perfumer had to be there to make sure that the mixture was right and aromatic. It couldn't stink. It had to be pleasant to the smell. It is to be salted and pure and sacred. That's where the lye and the salt and the wine come in. Grind some of it into powder and place it in front of the Ark of the Covenant, the law in the tent of the meeting, where I will meet with you, says Exodus 30, 34, and 36. And so you can see that these precise amounts were around the bowl of the incense. So they took of the coals, put the coal there, and then put the incense on top of the coals. And it is said that Israelite women as far away from Jerusalem as Jericho, which is 15 miles down the road, did not have to wear perfumes because the sweet fragrance emanated from the Keteret in the temple and so filled the air. Incense is supposed to be a token of gladness, as it is written, "Oil and incense rejoice the heart," in Proverbs 27 and 9. Therefore, when he lit the menorah, the priest used to offer incense, as it says, "When he dresses the lamps, he shall burn incense on it, and when Aharon lights the lamps at evening, he shall burn incense upon it." Exodus 30, 7 through 8. So every time the menorah is lit, the incense must be lit on it, or at the same time. In the morning, he burns incense because of the joy brought by our Heavenly Father, as morning is a time of joy. And in the evening he burns incense to bring joy to Yahweh. Incense is ever a sign of joy. We're living in exciting times. In the late spring of 1992, the late Professor Vindal Jones, one of my mentors, of the Institute of Judeo-Christian Research, found an estimated 600 kilos of what looked like reddish dirt, uncovered at the north entrance of the Cave of the Columns, mentioned in the temple copper scroll. The team members reported detecting the smell, a unique smell of cinnamon, present in this red dirt substance. Now, you've smelt the incense as it goes around. Here's the end product. Dr. Terry Hooter performed an exhaustive analysis and stated that, and I quote, the red-brown spice sample is composed of 9 different unique plants. The plants are recognizable both by pollen and organic mercurial types, end of quote. Dr. Hooter listed that these are 3 kinds of cinnamon, saffron, balsam, myrrh, galbanum, clove, spikenard, costus, and frankincense. Dr. Marvin Adelman of the Weissman Institute said, and I quote, positively identified Borit Kashina Lai, excuse me, and I'll quote that again, positively identified as Borat Karshina Lai, which is one of the ingredients spelled out in the Talmud, end of quote. What the Institute team had found was the Ketoret. The quantity of the incense is also significant. It corresponds to the amount prepared for 1 year of daily incense service. Curiously, when young Muhammad Adib discovered the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1947, only 2 of the 10 clay jars contained scrolls. The other were filled in what looked like, and I quote, reddish dirt, end of quote. They didn't keep those, unfortunately. So they were destroyed, but isn't it interesting that these exiled priests who had ferreted away much of the Jerusalem priestly library and put them in the caves of Qumran also took with them the holy incense of that temple. The significance of the unearthing of the Ketoret in our day solidifies the possibility that we are the second wilderness generation. Rabbi Moses Luzzatto said this, and I quote, redemption requires many preparations and extremely far-reaching and powerful actions, both on Yahweh's part and ours. These are known to the enlightened who have attempted to walk in wisdom's ways and understood its truth. At the time of the redemption, when wisdom will permeate the world, all will then see and understand retroactively how great were the miracles, both hidden and revealed, that Yahweh performed for us throughout history. For when Israel imagined that he had hidden his face from them and forsaken them in their exile, he was actually preparing goodness and blessing for them, great storehouses of spiritual illumination, whose expansiveness has no end and whose vastness has no limit. It was into these storehouses that he constantly placed all that is precious and pleasant, the treasures of kings at all times and at every moment, until the great day when they would be filled with such goodness that the mouth cannot express, the ear cannot hear, nor even the heart contemplate. And when the time comes for the destined rest of the great Sabbath to become manifested in the world, all of these storehouses will be open. All that is precious will emerge from them and be given to Israel in payment for the difficult service they performed in their exile. End of quote. So I believe that when we found that incense in our generation, and I say we because Dr. Jones believed that he was doing it for all of Israel, that this is the time. We're on the verge of going into that great messianic day. But right before he comes, the Messiah comes, some of the storehouses will be opened up and the blessings will come forth. And the first was the anointing oil, and then came the holy incense. With the exact ingredients known, Reuven Prager of Beged Ivri began making the essential oils. But was it lawful? But as for the incense which you shall not make any for yourselves according to its composition. It shall be to you holy for Yahweh, Exodus 30 and 37 says. Reuven thought he had found a loophole in Scripture. And Rabbi Menachem Burstein, rabbi of the Shlomo College of Temple Studies, agreed with him. The ban need not apply if the ingredients are steamed to extract their essential oils rather than ground into powder as a prohibited spice. It was an emotional moment for Reuven, he says, and I quote, I rubbed the oil into my beard in pails. And Reuven recalls, and I ran to the kotel, the western wall, as fast as I could, and I wiped my face against the stones of the wall, and I whispered to them, do you remember? Do you remember this smell? Chelbana, or galbanum in English. The temple explains that the 10 of these spices had good fragrance, while an 11th spice, the galbanum, had an unpleasant odor. And the obvious question is, why include a stinky spice? Well, the community of prayer always requires a minyan. And this is also similar to the Keteret, that it contains 10 good-smelling spices and one unpleasant spice. Thus, by including the chalbina, along with the other 10 spices, the Torah alludes to the fact that the prayers of a minyan cannot arise up like incense until an 11th man, a sinner, joins them. Says the Talmud tractate, Keretot 6a. You see, our actions are broken down into evil smoke or righteous incense. David says, you give heed to prayer, which is not from deceitful lips, but as for the guilty, let his prayers become sin, says Psalm 17 and 1, and repeated in Psalms 109:7. Our prayers are supposed to ascend like sweet incense. Yahweh has warned us, the commonwealth of Israel, when you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Yes, even though you multiply prayers, I'll not listen. Your hands are covered with blood. Wash yourself, make yourself clean. Remove the evil of your deeds from my sight and cease to do evil, says Isaiah 1:15 through 16. Now you see why we go through these different things. We go through the casting of our cares upon the bread and then putting that upon the water. You see why we go through the immersion in the water to cleanse ourselves. And tonight we will come before Yahweh and we will offer him the holy incense. When the evil-smelling chalbana is left on its own, its smell is unbearably bitter. The same is true of those who have gotten trapped in their own wicked cycle of sin and guilt. Reconciling the evil person back into covenant through the blood of Yeshua, causing him to receive the nefesh hashamayim, that new birth, is important for him and for us, because this chalbana, part of us, contains something important for the integrity of the community. Still, that person needs the actions of the other 10 attributes to change them into a sweet-smelling incense, lest the evil person think that he or she is okay. No, there must be teshuvah. There must be that turning from their wicked way in order to effect true reconciliation. We must all turn from our wicked way. We must all do teshuvah. Evil is essentially parasitic. Since it has no life of its own, it depends on whatever sparks of holiness it can steal to nourish itself. The community can then reclaim the very energy that until now was being used to undermine and subvert the community. To call rebellious, gossiping, compromising believers to prayer without teshuva is to lead them into sin against Yahweh that is worse than all the other evils in their lives combined. We had better get to the laver and cleanse ourselves before we offer the incense before the mercy seat. Offering prayer to Yahweh through unclean lips and lifting polluted hands can bring down his wrath and perpetuate hideous judgment.
Yahweh's word likens prayer to the sweet incense aroma that goes up before Yahweh to the throne. And David prayed as we did, "Let my prayer be counted as incense before thee, the lifting of my hands as the evening sacrifice," in Psalms 141 and 2. Rabbi Yohanan removes the veil and shows us the heavenly. "And when he had taken the book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having each one a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints." Revelations 5 and 8. I believe this incense includes all the praying, all the praising, all the worshiping of Yahweh's people. So in a sense, we've already begun to offer up incense, haven't we? So let's talk for a few minutes about the sacred and the profane. There are two kinds of incense mentioned in Yahweh's word. One is pure, the other is strange. "You shall overlay it with pure gold. You shall put this altar in front of the veil, and that is near to the Ark of the Testimony, in front of the mercy seat that is over the Ark of the Testimony, where I will meet with you. And Aharon shall burn fragrant incense on it. He shall burn it every morning when he trims the lamps. And when Aharon trims the lamps at twilight, he shall burn incense. There shall be a perpetual incense before Yahweh throughout your generations. You shall not offer any strange incense on this altar, or burn offerings or meal offerings, and you shall not pour out a libation on it." Exodus 33-9. Many times you'll come in here visiting me, and there'll be that strong smell of incense that I burned in the morning as I was praying for you and this congregation and myself. I always offer incense. This is so important because I want a perpetual smell in the building and before Yahweh. "You shall offer no strange prayers on my altar." There was a death penalty on who offered strange incense to Yahweh. In the Tanakh, in what the world calls the Old Testament, Yahweh was trying to show us his heart against corrupt worship. He intended to show us how serious this matter of corrupt worship is in his sight. Now, Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aharon, took their respective fire pans and, after putting fire in them, placed incense on it and offered strange fire before Yahweh. When he had not commanded them, and fire came out from the presence of Yahweh and consumed them, and they died before Yahweh. And then Moses said to Aharon, "It is what Yahweh spoke, saying, 'By those who come near me, I will be treated as holy, and before all peoples, I'll be honored.'" So Aharon, therefore, kept silent. Leviticus 10, 1 through 3. There before the altar of incense lay the two sons of Aharon. These two were righteous men. They had gone up the mountain, ate and drank with the express image of Yahweh in Exodus 24 and 11. But now these two young priests dared approach Yahweh to offer incense with polluted hands and heart. The fire of Yahweh leaps out of the golden altar of incense and kills them. And they're dragged out to the front of the sanctuary. Even though he was their father, Aharon could not show any emotion. And as parents, how painful that would be. What kind of Elohim is this? Righteous men killed at the altar. I'll tell you what kind of Elohim he is. He's a holy Elohim that tells you how he wants to be worshipped. And he gives you what he wants back in worship. Nadab and Abihu violated the direct command of Yahweh. Now Yahweh spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aharon when they had approached the presence of Yahweh and died. And Yahweh said to Moses, "Tell your brother Aharon that he shall not enter at any time into the holy place inside the veil before the mercy seat, which is on the ark, lest he die." Leviticus 16, 1 through 2. We are to obey Yahweh's Torah exactly. They had offered strange fire. The word strange is zur. And it's to become estranged, to be an adulterer, prostitute, or a harlot, to be alienated, or an outsider. It was what they had become. They had become rebellious, adulterous of heart. They were priests who had become alienated by this one action from Yahweh because of profanity and presumption. It is what you are and what you have become that makes your worship what it is, holy or strange. Unrepented sin becomes a stronghold for Hasatan, and it corrupts everything you bring to Yahweh. Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Says Matthew 5, 23 and 24. How many of you remember the story of Korah? Korah ben Issachar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, and certain Reubenites, Datan and Abiram, sons of Eliab, and On ben Pelet, they had dared to offer strange fire. With them were 250 Israelite men, well-known community leaders who had been appointed elders of the council. Each one had their own reason for joining the conspiracy. They came as a group to oppose Moses and Aharon and said to them, "Now Korah, son of Issachar, son of Kohath, son of Levi, took to himself along with the Datan and Abiram, sons of Eliab, and On, son of Pelet, and descendants of Reuben, and they rose up against Moses." And what did Moses say? Well, Korah says, "You've gone too far. The whole community is holy. Every one of them are holy, and Yahweh is with them. Why then do you set yourself above Yahweh's assembly?" Korah says. In other words, isn't it body ministry? You know the story. Korah gathered all of his followers in opposition to Moses and Aharon at the entrance of the tent of meeting, and the glory of Yahweh appeared to the entire assembly. And Yahweh said to Moses and Aharon, "I'd get away from them. Separate yourself from this assembly so I can put an end to them at once." Numbers 16:45. So when Moses heard it, he fell on his face, and he spoke to Korah and all of his company, saying, "Tomorrow morning Yahweh will show you who is his and who is holy, and will cause him to come near to him. That one whom he chooses, he will cause to come near to him. Do this, take censers, Korah, and all your company, put fire in them, and put incense in them before Yahweh tomorrow, and it shall be that the man whom Yahweh chooses is the Holy One. You take too much upon yourself, you sons of Levi," says Numbers 16:4 through 7. And then Moses became very angry and said, to Yahweh, "Do not accept their offering. I have not taken so much as a donkey from them, nor have I wronged any of them," says Numbers 16:15. Again, Moses and Aharon fell on their face to intercede, and they cried out to Yahweh, "O Elohim, Elohim of the spirits of all mankind, will you be angry with the entire assembly when only one man sins?" Numbers 16:22. So every man took his censer, put fire in it, laid incense on it, and stood at the door of the tabernacle of meeting with Moses and Aharon, and Korah gathered all the congregation against them at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then the glory of Yahweh appeared to all the congregation. Says Numbers 16:18 through 19. And then Yahweh specifically speaks to Moses, saying, "Say to the assembly, move away from the tents of Korah, Datan, and Abiram." Numbers 16:23 and 24. Moses told the people the specific orders of Yahweh. As soon as he finishes saying all this, the ground under them splits apart, and the earth opens its mouth and swallows them with their household and all of Korah's men and all of his possessions. And they went down alive into the grave with everything they owned. And the earth closed over them, and they perished, and they were gone from the community. At their cries, all the Israelites around them fled, shouting, "The earth is going to swallow us up too!" In Numbers 16:34, and fire came out from Yahweh and consumed the 250 men co-conspirators. What strange incense is pouring out of the lips of many compromising servants of Yahweh today? Many are counseling rebellion. Many have lost the fear of Yahweh and the respect for His delegated authorities. They have no vision of the holiness of Yahweh. A holy man of Yahweh turns people away from sin. A corrupt minister causes many to stumble. My covenant with them was one of life and peace, and I gave them to Him as an object of reverence. So He revered me and stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in His mouth, and unrighteousness was not found on His lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness. He turned many back from iniquity, for the lips of a priest should preserve knowledge. And men should seek instruction from his mouth, for he is the messenger of Yahweh Zebaot. Malachi 2, 5 through 7. So, we cannot offer a strange fire. We must be holy as he is holy. Amen. Yahweh singles out those who have gotten soft against sin. Ministers who refuse to show Yahweh's people the difference between the sacred and the profane. For I hate divorce, says Yahweh, the Elohim of Israel. And him who covers his garment with wrong, says Yahweh Zebaot. So take heed to your spirit that you do not deal treacherously. You have wearied Yahweh with your words. Yet you say, how have we wearied him? In that you say, everyone who does evil is good in the sight of Yahweh, and he delights in them. Or where is the Elohim of justice? Says Malachi 2, 16 through 17. Ezekiel was given a vision of the elders of Israel. Then he brought me to the entrance of the court. And when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall. And he said to me, son of man, now dig through the wall. So I dug through the wall, and behold, an entrance. And he said to me, go in and see the wicked abominations that they are committing here. So I entered, and I looked, and behold, every form of creeping things and beast and detestable things with all the idols of the house of Israel were carved on the wall all around. And standing in front of them were 70 elders of the house of Israel, with Yahazaniah ben Shaphan standing among them, each man with a censer in his hand, and the fragrance of the cloud of the incense rising. Then he said to me, son of man, do you see what the elders of the house of Israel are committing in dark? Each man in the room of his carved images, for they say Yahweh doesn't see us. Yahweh's forsaken the land. In Ezekiel 8, 7 through 12. They thought Yahweh is overlooking sin as long as we pray and offer incense. Yahazaniah means Yahweh hears. What arrogance sin causes. They actually believed Yahweh was hearing their prayers, even though they were laden with sin. You offered my incense before these idols, Yahweh said. You sat on a splendid couch with a table arranged before it, on which you had set my incense and my oil, says Ezekiel 23:41. The furniture of the tabernacle nor the temple includes a couch. You cannot just add furniture. What is a couch doing in the temple? You can't just offer any kind of incense. It's got to be holy incense. And he shall take a fire pan full of coals of fire from upon the altar before Yahweh, and two handfuls of finely ground sweet incense, and bring it inside the veil, and he shall put the incense on the fire before Yahweh, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the ark of the testimony, lest he die. Leviticus 16, 12 through 13. The mercy seat represents the very presence of Yahweh. If the priest had pure incense and pure garments, he could come with confidence to the throne of grace to obtain mercy. He would not die, but would see the glory of his presence. And there's a scene in Revelation 8, so awesome, so incredible, I can barely comprehend it. And when he broke the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the seven angels who stood before Yahweh, and seven trumpets were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar holding a golden censer. And much incense was given to him that he might add it to the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which is before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints went up before Yahweh out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer, and he filled it with the fire of the altar and threw it to the earth. And there followed peals of thunder and sounds and flashings of lightning and an earthquake. And the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound them. And the first sounded. And there came hailfire mixed with blood. And they were thrown down to the earth, and a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. Revelations 8, 1 through 7. In Revelations 5, Rabbi Yohanan describes the thunderous, exultant voices of the living creatures, the 24 elders, and the millions of angels, all of them singing with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who has been slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise, says Revelation 5:12. What a loud and glorious scene as every created thing in heaven lifted voices in concerts of praise, and every created thing which is in heaven and upon earth and under the earth and on the seas and all things in them. And I heard them saying, to him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb be blessings and honor and glory and dominion and power forever and ever. And the four living creatures kept saying, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshipped. Revelation 5:13-14. In Revelation 6, we hear also the loud crying of the martyrs underneath the altar. These are all the ones that have died in Messiah and have died in the covenant. And when he broke the fifth seal, I saw underneath the altar the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of Yahweh and because of the testimony which they had maintained. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Yahweh, holy and true, will thou refrain from judging and avenging our blood on those who dwell upon the earth? Revelation 6:9-10. The seventh seal. In Revelation 8, all heaven is hushed. For nearly half an hour, the elders kneel in silent wonder. The living creatures, the Kerubim, the Zarapinim, all hushed and speechless. Even the martyrs are silent. Angelic choirs are not singing. The harps have been put aside, and there's not a sound in heaven. All is hushed. Why? Why? It's because the seventh seal has been broken, and they have seen the frightful judgments written on the seventh document. Seven angels with seven trumpets stand ready to inflict death, destruction, and fiery judgments upon the earth. So there was silence in heaven. This indescribable silence has something to do with prayer, and it has something to do with incense. The time has come for a holy Elohim to bring to his altar the worship of his people for righteous judgment. He is going to put his all-consuming fire under the incense to test the aroma. Will it be a sweet-smelling savor or a stench of strange fire in his nostrils? And another angel came and stood at the altar, holding a golden incense, and much incense was given to him that he might add it to the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before Yahweh, says Revelation 8:3. That angel. This would be the test of time. What smell would it make? Would it be sweet, or would it be a stench? I hope you can see what I see. I see two kinds of incense. There is much incense which was given to the angel, the tainted prayers of false worshipers, and the incense already burning on the altar, the pure, holy incense of the sanctified. The fire on that altar has never gone out. That pure, holy worshiping has continually been a sweet savor to Yahweh. In Exodus 37:29, we learn that the holy, pure incense was the mark of a perfumer. In Ecclesiastes 10:1, it says, dead flies make a perfumer's oil stink. The perfumer is one who mixes oil and incense. The angel of Revelation 8 is Yahweh's perfumer, the one who mixes the incense. But he will not mix the strange, stinking incense corrupted with dead flies. Remember, Hasatan is called Baal-zebub, the Lord of the flies. Do not encourage each other to worship with filthy flies in their incense. The only prayer that Yahweh will hear from them is a repentant prayer. The word reveals that stubborn and unrepentant hearts are storing up wrath for the day of judgment. Do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of Yahweh leads you to repentance? But because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of Yahweh, says Romans 2:4-5. The angel was told to mix this much incense, this much praying, with the incense already on the altar. But when Yahweh's consuming fire touches it, something happens. The angel took the censer and he filled it with the fire of the altar and threw it to the earth. And there followed peals of thunder and sounds of flashing of lightning and an earthquake, says Revelation 8:5. But to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, wrath, and indignation, there'll be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Greek. Romans 2, 8 through 9. I hear it often said, if Christians will pray, Yahweh will spare this nation from judgment. But we forget to add, if they repent, if they keep my Sabbath, if they love the name, if they confess and forsake their sins and hold fast to the covenant, then Yahweh will hear from heaven and heal this land. Not just if people pray. My people who are called by my name, you've got to be called by his name. What name does he call? He says, Israel is always before me. I've engraved them upon my hands. I'll never forget them. You've got to be part of his people. You can't remain what you always were. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways to Teshuva, then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayer made in this place. What place? The place where he puts his name. 2 Chronicles 7, 13 through 15. Keep justice and do righteousness, for my salvation is about to come and my righteousness to be revealed. Blessed is the man who does this and the son of man who lays hold upon it, who keeps from defiling the Sabbath and keeps his hand from doing any evil. Do not let the son of the foreigner who has joined themselves to Yahweh speak, saying, Yahweh has utterly separated me from his people. Nor let the eunuch say, here I am, a dry tree. For thus says Yahweh to the eunuch who keeps my Sabbath and chooses what pleases me and hold fast to my covenant, even to them I will bring in my house and within my walls a place and a name better than that of the sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And also the sons of the foreigners who join themselves to Yahweh to serve him, to love the name of Yahweh, to be his servants, everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath and holds fast my covenant, even them I will bring to my holy mountain. What's the holy mountain? The temple mount. And make them joyful in my house of prayer. What's the house of prayer? The temple. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices, their incense and their offerings will be accepted upon my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations. The sovereign Yahweh who gathers the outcasts of Israel says, yet I will gather to him others besides those that are gathered to them. Isaiah 56, 1 through 8. Yahweh only hears and answers holy prayers from holy hearts. The eyes of Yahweh are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry, says Psalms 34 and 15. Let millions of churchgoers, synagogue-goers, mosque-goers, temple-goers, and shrine-goers repent! Let multitudes of people repent and stretch out their hands calling for mercy and blessing. Yahweh is just about to vomit out his judgments on all unrepentant flesh. Tainted prayers from sinful lips practicing pagan worship do not shield from judgment. They cause judgment. In Proverbs 8 and 17, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. Then Yahweh said to me, a conspiracy has been found among the men of Judah, among the inhabitants of Jerusalem. They have turned back to their iniquities of their ancestors, who refused to hear my words, and they have gone after other gods to serve them. The house of Israel and the house of Judah have broken my covenant, which I made with their fathers. Therefore, thus says Yahweh, behold, I am bringing disaster on them, which they will not be able to escape. Though they will cry to me, yet I'll not listen to them, says Jeremiah 11. 9 to 11. But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your Elohim, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, your fingers with iniquity, your lips have spoken falsehood, your tongue muttered wickedness. For our transgressions are multiplied before thee, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquities. Transgressing and denying Yahweh, and turning away from our Elohim, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving in and uttering from the heart of lying words. Isaiah 59, 2, 3, 12, and 13. We have a holy intercessor, a perfect high priest, Messiah Yeshua. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven, in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which Yahweh erected and not man, says Hebrews 8, 1 through 2. Therefore, he is able to save us to the uttermost, those who come to Yahweh through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once and for all when he offered himself up. Hebrews 7:25-27. He has sent the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Menachem, to search out a people who will come into the holy place with pure incense. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of Yahweh. Romans 8:26-27. As we come before Yahweh tonight and place our incense upon the altar, you've got to ask yourself, will it be sweet or strange? It'll be sweet if you pour out your heart to Yahweh. If you repent to him tonight and you turn from your wicked way and walk again anew and afresh with him. As we've cleansed ourselves, as we've cast our cares upon the bread and thrown it into the water, now our hearts are ready. They should be. I'm going to give you a little time as I ask them to play Avenu Melkeinu, our Father and our King. When you're ready, get out of your seat. I'll meet you at that golden altar, and I'll offer you incense to offer before Yahweh. You take the golden spoon and you'll place the incense upon the burning coals. You'll smell that incense. You'll know your condition. May I say, a few years ago, a young lady that I knew well, that had come off and on to the fellowship, she came forward. I hadn't seen her in years. When she showed up at the Kedaret service that evening, unbeknownst to me, she had gone back into prostitution. I didn't know it. She was sitting amongst the members, and she had been a member for many years. She came up and offered fire, or offered incense, and fire leaped out of the coals at her. It so startled her that she took two steps back, and she said, "What does that mean, Rabbi?" And I said, "You've offered up strange fire, hon. Now go and repent." She went back to her chair, and I said this discreetly. It was between me and her. She went back and sat down. I didn't see her again for years. What am I saying? Remember Nadab and Abihu? The fire leapt out at them and consumed them. We're not playing games. We're coming before a holy Elohim, and I want us to offer up holy fire to him. And that comes from a repentant heart. Amen. So as this song is played, draw near to Yahweh and he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded, says James 4:8. I know that's what I'm going to do, and I hope that's what you do before you offer before Yahweh.